Good evening. You're watching the news at 7:30 on ATV. I'm Emily Su.
And I'm Edna Zhe. Here's a look at tonight's top stories.
No more fresh chicken for next 3 weeks as poultry wholesalers protest against new rules to stop bird flu.
Democratic Party leader condemns Macau for blacklisting Beijing's critics after she's barred entry for a holiday.
Chinese state media join public in blaming Shanghai authorities for deadly New Year's Eve stampede. There will be no more fresh chicken on the menu for Hong Kong as poultry wholesalers are suspending business for the next 21 days to protest against new government rules to stop bird flu.
Health Minister Koeng Man warned that all live poultry sales may have to be stopped in the longer term if traders can't set aside self-interest for the sake of public health. ATV's Rachel Leung reports.
Local poultry wholesalers have made good on their threat to take fresh chicken off the menu for everyone in Hong Kong. They won't be doing any more business for the next 21 days. They are upset about new arrangements requiring them to take all live chickens to a segregation facility in Tau Kuling for inspection, then deliver them to different markets across the city. In the past, they would deliver the chickens to the Changsha Wan wholesale market, where the birds would be inspected by authorities, then sold to retailers there. Now that the government has shut down the wholesale market for 3 weeks after slaughtering 19,000 chickens there because of a bird flu scare, wholesalers are finding the new arrangements too troublesome. Some of them had threatened to protest by setting chickens loose in the middle of the city. Food and Health Secretary Koeng Man today urged poultry wholesalers to put public health ahead of their own short-term interests. Co said the size of the Tau Kuling site makes it impossible to be used as a wholesale market. But he's willing to consider shortening the 21-day embargo on live chicken imports that was prompted by the discovery of the deadly H7N9 strain of bird flu in samples from the mainland. At the same time, Co warned that authorities may have to ban the sale of live poultry altogether in Hong Kong if the industry doesn't cooperate on this matter of public health. He insisted that the contingency measures taken by the government are necessary to protect the public, so it's up to the people themselves to decide in the longer term if the live poultry trade should be scrapped altogether. The idea has been floated in the past as the ultimate solution to tackle bird flu, but it's a hard sell in a city that has a tradition of eating fresh chicken, which is a staple meat. For the next few weeks, consumers will be getting a taste of what it will be like without live chickens. Rachel Leung, ATV News.
Democratic Party chairwoman Emily Lau has condemned Macau authorities for blacklisting Beijing's critics after she was stopped from entering the city for a holiday.
She was told it was for safety reasons, but given no further explanation, as she became the latest pro-democracy figure to be turned away from Macau.
Emily Lau was not a happy holiday traveler today. The Democratic Party chairwoman had gone to Macau with three friends for some rest and recreation, but was stopped at the ferry pier when she arrived. Immigration officials took her to a room and told her she would not be allowed into Macau because of safety reasons, which they did not explain. After signing documents, Lau was then put on a ferry back to Hong Kong. The veteran lawmaker and democracy campaigner called it regrettable as well as ridiculous. She accused Macau authorities of using a blacklist to keep out pro-democracy activists and people critical of Beijing. Macau has adopted a policy of one country, one system, instead of operating as an SAR like Hong Kong, she complained. While the confiscation of her home return permit prevents her from traveling to the mainland, Lau pointed out that she has been allowed into Macau for holidays before. There's speculation that Macau has become extra cautious because of Hong Kong's civil disobedience movement, which led to mass protests and road blockades last year. Just last month, League of Social Democrats lawmaker Leung Kwok Hung and several activists were turned back when they tried to enter Macau during President Xi Jinping's visit. Some of that extra caution was evident when reporters and children waiting in the rain at the airport were barred from using umbrellas, which have become a symbol of the pro-democracy campaign.
Veteran Beijing loyalist Rita Fan has endorsed an electoral model proposed by legal scholar Albert Chen, which would allow voters to leave a blank ballot if they're unhappy with all the chief executive candidates chosen by the official nominating committee in the 2017 poll.
Professor Chen's proposal, as far as I can see, is not contradicting the basic law. However, I believe the actual situation in Hong Kong should also be taken into consideration. And that is what has happened in the past in Hong Kong's elections. Hong Kong's elections, there are the district council's election, the legislative council's election, and there is a way, there is a usual practice in how to deal with blank votes.
Fan said the way blank votes are dealt with in the forthcoming chief executive poll cannot deviate too far from other elections. Under Chen's proposal, if more than half of voters cast blank votes, the election will be declared null and void, and an interim leader would have to be elected for a 2 to 3 year term. Besides Fan, other loyalists like LegCo President Zhang Yuk-sing have said Beijing would be more likely to accept Chen's idea than the opposition camp's demand for genuine universal suffrage.
China's state media has joined the public in blaming Shanghai's city government for the New Year's Eve stampede, which left 36 people dead and 47 injured.
Police in the country's financial hub have admitted they underestimated the size of the crowd, but denied the stampede was caused by people rushing to pick up fake U.S. dollar bills thrown from a nearby building. This footage from New Year's Eve shows a group of young revelers trying to stop a deadly stampede in Shanghai's famous Fun District. The youngsters can be seen yelling at the surging crowds to move away from their elevated platform ahead of the midnight countdown and the light show along the riverfront. They're now being hailed as heroes, with netizens saying their actions saved many lives. Celebrations at Changi Square descended into chaos and horror when the stampede broke out less than half an hour before the midnight countdown. Most of the victims were young people who ended up being trampled on and suffocated. There's been speculation the crush was caused by a mad scramble for coupons that looked like U.S. dollar bills thrown down from a bar overlooking the area. But Shanghai police ruled out a connection after looking at surveillance footage. They said the fake money only attracted a small crowd, and it happened 12 minutes after the stampede, about 60 meters away from the crush. CCTV cameras focused on Changi Square did not show coupons floating in the air during the deadly chaos. Authorities identified some of the victims today. Most of them were in their 20s, the youngest aged just 12. A Malaysian exchange student is also understood to be on the injured list, but no Hong Kong resident has been named so far. Shanghai police admitted they had underestimated the size of the crowd and expressed regret over their failure to effectively intervene when the crowd flow increased irregularly at 11:30 p.m. According to them, 700 officers were on duty along the entire Bund waterfront, and another 500 were deployed to tackle the emergency. While Shanghai is in mourning, state media today joined in the chorus of public condemnation and concern over what happened on Wednesday night. The official Xinhua News Agency questioned why something like this could happen in China's financial hub, the country's most international and cosmopolitan city. Xinhua blamed it on a lack of vigilance from the government, which could not ignore responsibility. The disaster, which happened in China's financial hub of Shanghai, served as a wake-up call that the world's second-largest economy is still a developing country which has fragile social management, the agency declared.
A top Chinese diplomat has become the latest official to be investigated for corruption under a sweeping anti-graft campaign ordered by President Xi Jinping.
Zhang Kunshen's fall from grace marks the first time a foreign ministry official has been targeted in a corruption probe. ATV's Bo Leung reports.
In a low-key announcement today, the foreign ministry said Assistant Foreign Minister Zhang Kunsheng has been sacked for disciplinary violations. Officials speak for corruption. It marks the first time a top Chinese diplomat has been removed for such an offence as Beijing continues its sweeping campaign against graft. While the foreign ministry is often the face of the Chinese government, it has little power or influence compared with other departments. Zheng, who had held his post since 2011, was the most senior of the four assistant foreign ministers in the hierarchy. The 56-year-old from Shaanxi province is described as a specialist in Sino-US affairs. He made international headlines in 2012 when he gave US diplomats a dressing down over Washington's accusations that Beijing was deliberately escalating regional tensions by building a military garrison in the South China Sea. His downfall is another milestone in President Xi Jinping's campaign to clean up the Communist Party by going after corrupt tigers as well as flies. The biggest tiger is former security czar Zhao Yongkang, who was expelled from the Communist Party last month and faces trial. Bo Leung, ATV News.
Overseas rescue teams have suspended the search for three climbers missing on New Zealand's highest mountain because of rough weather.
But first, in a roundup of international news, Indonesia has started the underwater search for the Malaysian passenger plane that crashed in the sea on Sunday. ATV's Ben O'Rourke reports.
Officials in Indonesia have been showing the media wreckage from the AirAsia plane that went down on Sunday while on its way from Surabaya to Singapore. At the same time, they're moving on to the next phase of their hunt for the missing Malaysian aircraft and taking the search underwater. Special sonar equipment has arrived at a relatively shallow area of the Java Sea, where the plane is believed to have sunk to the bottom with 162 people on board. More than a dozen bodies have been found so far, but bad weather is hampering the search for the main wreckage and the black box flight data recorders. Authorities in New Zealand say the search for three climbers on the country's highest mountain has been thwarted by high winds. The three climbers, two Germans and an Australian, were last seen on Mount Cook on Monday, according to local media. Search helicopters have been unable to fly to the upper parts of the mountain because of a gusty northwesterly. Police fear the men may have fallen to their deaths in a crevasse on the Linda Glacier. More aerial searches are planned over the next few days. One person is dead and six injured after a shooting at a New Year's Eve party in the Canadian city of Calgary. The victim was named as 26-year-old Abdullahi Ahmed, who was originally from Somalia. About 50 people, mainly African immigrants, were at the party and more than a dozen witnesses were interviewed. However, police complained that they were not being very cooperative. Authorities have appealed to the Somali community for information as they try to track down those responsible. Ben O'Rourke, ATV News.